Sportsman-like thing you can do on a rugby pitch.
What they used to do at school was put deep heat in the jock straps.
Is deep heat a euphemism?
No. It's a product.
It's a product.
That will warm up your genitals to a terrific degree during a scrum.
I don't understand this picture because I don't know anything about rugby. But
they're not playing rugby.
Oh, I see.
Tripping. You're not allowed to trip people up.
You're not allowed to trip people, but this is a truly terrible thing, and I think it doesn't reflect well, frankly, on England. It was 1889. New Zealand's rugby team, they were fairly newly formed, they came over to play against England in a place called Blackheath, and during the game, one of the English players, a man called Andrew Stoddard, he was tackled and his shorts accidentally ripped off. So, very nicely, the Kiwi players surrounded Stoddard to allow him to get back his modesty. Nice. While this was happening, another English player, a man called Frank Evershed, picked up the ball and scored a try. I know, Lou, right? Scored a try unopposed, which was allowed by the referee, a man called Roland Hill, who also happened to be the secretary of the English Rugby Football Union. Three of the Kiwi players went off in protest. They were so furious. England won the game 7-0, and the Kiwis were later forced to apologise for their players leaving the field.
No.
It's not a good story, is it? No. But I have a worse one. So almost 100 years later, so we're talking about 1986, the All Blacks, they endured a crotch-related incident. So there was a guy called Wayne Shelford. He went on to be captain. In one of the first games, he ended up at the bottom of the ruck. He lost four teeth and a French boot ripped open his scrotum. Very low groan there. And left a testicle hanging out. It was sewn together on the sidelines. It played on until way into the second half when he was knocked unconscious. He says he has no memory of the game. Let's play What's That Sign?
What's That Sign?
Okay, have a look at this first sign and can you tell me what it is for?
Wobbly truck.
Wobbly trucks.
Toasters in use.
So they did a survey by Quick Fit. They surveyed 45,000 drivers. 26% could not identify this sign. 100% of you on the panel. Anybody in the audience, put your hand up if you think you know what this is. Yes, darling, with the beard.
Adverse camber?
It is adverse camber.
Oh, wow.
Wow, I bet you're fun. yes, that'll be adverse camber. Yeah, that will be.
That's his safe word.
Adverse camber!
Like a town in Dorset, doesn't it? Oh, she's living in adverse camber at the moment. Try this one. What does this one mean? Anybody?
No waiting. Does it mean no waiting, sir? No. No, what's it mean?
Is that the Swedish flag?
No, the Swedish flag is blue and yellow.
I don't want to be shamed for just guessing, Sandy.
Does nobody know what this is? Yes, a gentleman in the red shirt.
Clearway.
It is a clearway, absolutely
same
right.
Same thing.
Well, it means no. You can't even stop and.
Yes!
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 That's what he said. No stopping!
No, you said no waiting.
Yes!
He said no stopping!
Okay, you can't wait. You can't even stop.
No, you can't!
I'm going to give you an extra point so that you don't have a seizure.
Person to get road rage sitting in a studio.
In the survey, 33% of people could not identify this sign. It is indeed a clearway. And the final one, let's have a look at this. Anybody know what this
sign?
Yes.
is that one don't take offence?
Don't take offence from the top of a barber's shop.
That is anybody know what it identifies?
Is it to do with a level crossing?
It is to do with a level crossing. What do the bars below it mean?
I'm just trying to lip read the man in the audience who knows everything. His wife's having the best afternoon of her life. It must be nice to be out the house, is it? Yeah.
Hands up, anybody who knows what this one means.
I bet you whoever knows the next answer will have a white beard.
No stopping on the level crossing. No, is not.
You need a sign for that?
Yes.
Shall we? This seems quite lucky to be parked so close to the station, actually. No waiting!
Baby hyraxes have to eat their parents' poo. Which is in the
They don't have to, come
yes,
on.
Yes, they do have to, Danny. They don't have the necessary bacteria to digest plant stuff, so a bit like baby koalas, the solution is to eat the mother's feces.
There's got to be another solution.
Get it while it's hot. Eat that before it goes cold.
So a hyrax is about this big. Well, it's about that big.
And its poo is this big.
What would you guess their closest relative to be?
Meerkat.
Yeah, you would think that, but it's not.
Well, it's not their parents if they're making them do that.
It's upset you, hasn't
it? Yeah, not. It's just not on.
No.
I think they could just have a yogurt or something.
Yeah. Something with friendly bacteria.
Yeah.
That would be much more civilized.
The nearest relative to a hyrax. Pick an animal.
Mouse, rat, cat, dog, raccoon.
Huge.
Elephant.
Huge.
Elephant. Tiger.
An elephant. No, an elephant.
Yeah. Elephants and sea cows or manatees. They share a fairly recent common ancestor.
It's going to come
ancestor.
On a couple of years' time when science got it wrong.
Can you believe we ever thought these three things were related?
One geneticist, one wrong decimal place.
Geneticist. One drunk geneticist.
OK, that one, and that one.
Can I just say that I think the elves were a little bit drunk because they said, I said, what was the common ancestor? And they did a picture for me. Just have a look at this. This is their view of what the common ancestor was. But you're very musical anyway, aren't you, darling? You've been a choreographer in your
time? I was a Bollywood dance choreographer, yeah, for a...
How cool is that?
Oh, my goodness.
God, give us a couple of moves.
My husband is obsessed with Bollywood dancing and he loves it. But if you could teach me a couple of signature moves to teach him, he would be thrilled.
OK, I'll teach everyone then.
OK.
Something simple.
OK, now, the common misconception of kind of Asian or Indian dance moves is the light bulb and pat the dog.
I can do that.
Which you can, but that's also racist, so...
I won't do that.
Do we have to get up?
No. You can do it sitting down. Because the beauty of Bollywood is a lot of the dancing is in the face.
Ah, OK.
If any of you have ever looked for a remote under a sofa, have you ever had to do that?
Yes.
So you kind of go like that. Yes. And you don't find it.
Yeah.
And then do the other hand. And do it together.
Like it.
And then middle finger to your thumb.
Kill the wasp.
And then throw the wasp away. Kill the wasp, throw the wasp away. Right, so let's do it together.
Okay, ready? Everybody,
right hand first.
Okay.
In, can't find it. In, can't find it. Found a wasp, through it. Found a wasp, through it. There you go.
Doing that. This is one of my least favourite things that I have ever seen. It is the most dubious rotating invention. It's called an apparatus for facilitating the birth of a child by centrifugal force. Oh, God. I know.
We have a cordon of slip fielders.
There was a net.
You want Ben Stokes in there somewhere.
Strap the woman to it, and she. The idea
doesn't look keen, the girl.
No. So the idea is to spin her around at high speed, and the baby is propelled out. caught in a small net. if you would like to shorten your life, the best place to go is the Heart Attack Grill in Las Vegas. You can eat for free if you weigh over 350 pounds or 25 stone. So, just for you, that's about three quarters of the weight of a blue whale's heart. That's quite a lot, and you are verified by being weighed at a cattle weighing station, and then you are led to your table, if you are more than 350 pounds, by your personal nurse. It's a waiter. And their signature quadruple bypass burger is just a shade under 10,000 calories. It's made, there it is, it's made of 4 half-pound beef patties, 20 strips of bacon, 8 slices of American cheese. I say cheese, it's American cheese. A whole tomato, half an onion, served in a bun coated with lard.
if you well, at least the presentation's gorgeous.
I know. If you finish it, your nurse will deliver you to your car in a wheelchair.
And then do we know anything about fecal matter?
Oh, I imagine we bound up for quite a while after all that protein.
If you don't finish it, she will spank you in front of the other diners.
Really?
Are you sure this is a real restaurant, not a dream?
It is a real restaurant. In 2013, the unofficial spokesman for the restaurant, he was 52, died of a heart attack. Three other people have died on site.
What?
In the restaurant.
The clue is in the fact that the dish has bypass in the neck.
Yes, I think that. Yeah. They do have a vegan option.
it's a vegan.
I thought we might start with a little bit of soup to begin. So you've each got a bowl here of beetroot soup. Mm. So what I want you to do is I want you to demonstrate, please, how to eat this bowl of beetroot soup without getting your ruff all red. Ooh. This did very well. Yeah. Oh. So I think you've definitely nailed it. I think that is the...
Whoa. I bought one of those Lazy Boy sofas.
Yeah.
And I can eat...
anything.
..completely horizontal.
OK, well, they didn't have those sofas in Elizabethan times. What they did have, in fact, was a spoon specifically for eating... You're just going to drink the... Do you like beetroot soup?
It's very nice.
I love all soup.
Yeah, but be careful with beetroot, because in the morning you'll think you need a colonoscopy.
Oh, yes.
See if that's any easier. Thank to have. This is a rough spoon. So roughs were...
Actually, very small.
Do you like this? Rather lovely, isn't it?
Mm.
There's more wobble with a longer spoon.
Oh, do you not like the longer spoon?
I find it more difficult.
Yeah. And what about if you fed each other? Would that be easier?
Oh, yes. Like, oh, yes.
I don't know if that would be easier.
This is...
Oh,
like...
I think that's rather beautiful. Oh. I think, yes.
Lady in the
tramp. Oh. No! All down Susan's ruff.
Oh, Susan, I'm sorry.
Tom!
The sight of you slurping that was so disgusting. I kind of dropped the spoon.
The strongest beer ever made, according to the Guinness World Records, was a beer called The End of History. It was made by the Scottish company Brewdog. It was 55% alcohol. So if you think vodka mostly is 40%.
What the hell?
When you've had a pint of that, this is what you see.
This is what you see. This is like some of my lockdown dreams.
Sent 10 of their investors a bottle of this particular beer mounted inside a taxidermy roadkill squirrel.
It's not drunk as a beer, though, is it? It's drunk in a shot glass.
It says it should be drunk in small serving. Yeah. Is entirely correct.
I bet this is in the inside locker of every RSPCA warden. Yeah, that's right, yeah. You care for him on the outside, inside, there you go. Turn him into a bottle, that's what I say. Bloody vermin! You're bloody vermin, that's what you are! That's the best you can hope for, you miserable little git! Turn him into an optic, that's what I say.
What happens when you have a bump on your head and you wake up with foreign language syndrome?
Okay.
You don't speak in foreign language, you speak in a foreign accent.
Clever.
Is correct.
Clever.
That's exactly right. You could just feel the trap door opening and closing.
Because if you could speak another language, then all I'd have done at school is just bash my head off the desk and go, oh! Yeah.
Bonjour.
No.
Oui, ça va bien. Merci.
No, it's just you speak in the accent.
Why do you do that face?
I don't know.
Relax
imagining smoking a Gaulois cigarette as well.
That's very odd.
Ça va bien. Merci beaucoup.
What? It's just so weird how you turn into a cartoon.
You're absolutely right. They simply have an impairment, a speech impairment, and the notion that they speak a foreign language, it's in the ear of the listener rather than in the mouth of the speaker. Sufferers have included George Michael. I don't know if you remember this. In 2012, he had pneumonia and he was briefly in a coma and he woke up with what sounded
like... You've got
like...
to have a faith. You've got to rock your body. Oh.
He had a West Country.
You've got to have faith.
A faith, you've got to have faith.
Eh? Wait, a careless whisper, he did.
Yeah.
When I hear about planets with more than one moon, I'm quite envious. Like, Jupiter's got several moons.
Well, well over 60. And we're
well
finding
over
more.
60?
Oh, yeah. The outer planets tend to sort of be... They're bigger and they sort of more gravity and stuff like that. But you see, our moon is the best moon.
Why?
compared with Earth, our moon is very big, and so it helps protect us. So asteroids, meteorites, things like that, the moon will take some of those knocks. You can see it on the craters. So the moon takes some of the knocks for us.
It's like a bouncer.
Yeah, that's it. Oh, it's still away. Yeah, I'll take that. Move on. Right.
If the Earth and the moon perhaps were formed at a similar time, and the Earth is in the Goldilocks zone with the water and the environment and the atmosphere, and so it is the moon, but the moon, nothing.
No, a really harsh environment. But the moon's so much smaller. If you talk the surface area of the moon, it's about slightly smaller than the surface area of Asia. So it's quite small in comparison. And also, being small, it's got lots less gravity. And so, yeah, if it did ever have an atmosphere, it's long gone.
So it's the size and the lack of gravity that stops it forming an atmosphere.
Yeah, also, as a result, it means the sun's rays blast it really hard. And so, for instance, temperature on the moon goes from minus 150 to plus 150. So
oh, I had a boiler like that once.
At the moment, this feels like the morning of a science exam and Maggie's the only child who's done anything.
I saw a brilliant sign once, and it was in China, and it was in English, on a remote island off Hong Kong. And it was the most brilliant sort of existential sign. Basically, it said... It was one of those signs where there's a map and it's supposed to show you where you are and there's, like, an arrow.
Yeah.
And, but it's been weathered so much that all the information was gone. So it just said, you are here. But it didn't show... There was no map. It was just...
Nothing else.
It was like, you are... Yes, I am here. I exist.
Come on.
Where does this man keep his radio transmitter?
Oh. Where's his penis?
Well, that's...
Who leaves the house without their penis?
Weirdly. That is part of the answer.
Oh. All of us that have penises keep our careful radio transmitters in them.
You could.
Really?
What?
You could.
Where?
Yes.
I picked up Classic FM earlier.
Who are you shagging?
So during the Cold War, the CIA developed a radio, obviously just for the boys. It was a secret radio hidden in a fake scrotum. I know, it's a general...
Oh, my God.
All right, that is an overreaction to the scrotum.
No, it's not.
Do you know what's offensive about that? I had to pose for 8 hours for that.
You out.
They said it'd be tastefully done.
Well, so you're the only comedian with a detachable scrotum. That's why you got...
It was the pilots. Pilots who might be captured and searched, for example. Obviously, our action man could not. I don't know. Couldn't pull this off. I was going to say, but I don't know what the expression is. Anyway, I am told spies could slip it over an existing.
Oh, so it'd be going over the normal scrotum?
Yes, and then
you could slip anything over your scrotum.
Well, apparently you had to put it on one testicle at a time. I'm just telling you...
What, and then staple it?
I think it would just...
Suction? That's rubberized like a swimming hat.
I think you pop...
If it's suction, it's not the getting it on I'm worried about, it's the getting it off.
Yeah.
Is that a one-size-fits-all?
I've run out of information.
this kind of thing of eating locusts and bugs and things like that about finding alternative sources of protein.
I've tried locusts. That is not pleasant.
I had a locust badgie and it was one of the worst things I've had in my
what's
life.
What's a badgie?
It's like an onion pakora thing. So it's an Indian.
Do you mean badgie?
A badgie.
Oh, I.
Sorry.
You said budgie.
I thought you said badgie. I was thinking like a badger, but you wouldn't call a badger a barger, would you?
No.
I ran over a barger the other day.
The BBC is funded. You hear all sorts of voices on the BBC, one of which is corrected on her pronunciation of badgie. I mean, I have a look at badgie.
I just misunderstood.
Was that more understandable to your ears?
It's my mistake, not
I had a locust badgie. I'll do it the whole show like this now. So, he hasn't understood a word I've said. I had a locust badgie the other day.
The thing is, darling, you don't need to do that, because when we put this show out, we'll use subtitles. It's time for another socially distanced record attempt, specially created for us by Guinness World Records, and we are going to do the most Christmas crackers pulled by an individual in 30 seconds. OK, the number to beat is 20. Craig is here to judge again. Alan and Justin, you're going to be taking this one on. So there's an important condition, isn't there, Craig, that we have to be able to hear the bang of each cracker, is that right?
Yeah, each cracker has to crack, so we'll count them backstage to make sure each of the papers...
has actually gone.
Loaded, yeah.
OK, so you may put your crackers out on your on a table in front of you. Oh, that's my boy. Because all the gifts might fly out, I'm just going to put
good
on...
Good to wear goggles. Good idea.
Because, honestly, a pack of playing cards... OK, I've got my safety glasses.
Come on, Alan.
Right. Hand over to Craig.
OK, so start with your hands behind your back, please.
Oh. So this one, you have to stop when the music does.
OK.
Craig?
OK, you have 30 seconds in 3, 2, 1, go.
One. Two.
Go! 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 What a nice technique. Look at that! That could have had my eye out. There are nail clippers.
Environmentally, this is a disaster as well.
Yeah. It smells incredible.
It's what really did Father good. Christmas do when he went speed dating?
He pulled a cracker.
He pulled a cracker!
Are you doing the citizenship test?
Yes, it's...
It's very complicated.
It's very complicated.
No English person can pass it.
No.
It is absurd.
It's not possible. Yeah. I secretly wrote out all the questions from the citizenship test, and I made it into 100 questions, and I presented it as a family quiz at Christmas. And... people go, this is so hard. Why? Oh, I don't know. Who knows about this stuff? And no one passed. No one got close. Yeah. So no one. I said, none of you, none of you, all of you, out. You know?
Also, it's weird that they think, like, facts about the Magna Carta will make me a better British citizen.
Yes. Yeah.
It's very odd. Mm.
What do you think should be on the citizenship test?
Should the cream or the jam go on the scone
first? Yes, exactly.
That's the kind of thing.
Milk in first, then tea bag. No, only in a mug, though. Yeah. Only in a mug for tea.
Yeah. Yeah.
And then
what
something
is the correct British response to a nuclear conflagration? Mustn't grumble.
Mustn't, yeah.
That kind of thing.
What do you say when you've been to somewhere amazing? Not too bad.
Bad.
That's what you say.
That's the sort of stuff.
How was the Lake District? Not too bad.
Yeah.
Would have been a lot worse.
You should be able to name all the fielding positions in cricket.
That's true, yes.
Whose genitals are 7 feet longer than they used to be?
Don't know where they found that picture. Are we talking specifically male genitals?
We are, darling. Okay. We're talking about a penis that's 7 foot longer than it used to be.
The back row put his hand up.
Did you put your hand up, darling? Do you know what it is?
No, I just wanted to brag.
You understand?
Oh, my God.
Put your 7-foot-long Billy.
That's amazing.
It's no wonder we had to sit you at the back.
is that your girlfriend you've sat beside?
His girlfriend 6 rows in front.
Is it to do with, like, a medical condition?
No, it is to do with a piece of art. It is carved into a hillside.
Oh, it's the Rude Man of CERN.
It is the CERN Abbas Giant, or the Old Man of CERN. It is indeed known as the Rude Man of CERN.
Oh!
So he's a 200-foot-tall chalk carving in Dorset.
Look at that.
Have you ever seen this?
Yes,
I have. Has a notably large... Well, he's well-endowed, let's just put it that way. But he wasn't always this well-endowed. So, initially, his proud member was just 16 foot long. Now, you would think that's quite big, but however, if you think about scale, so if you imagine a 6-foot man has a 6-inch penis, he's 200 foot, you would imagine him to have a 200-inch penis, which is about 16 foot long.
Right.
But sometime around 1908, for reasons we don't know why, they merged his penis with his belly button and gave him an extra 7 foot.
You know what's weird? When I look at that, I see a shy little girl with pigtails licking a lollipop. Having a lovely time. Go, I love my lollipop.
Yeah. Then she's got like Pippi Longstocking hair.
Yeah. And then she's just got a little bun on her head.
Yeah. Maybe we've misinterpreted this for years. There are lots of creatures with prehensile tails, as the seahorses and anteaters, harvest mice, a tree pangolin. And there are also creatures with extraordinary things. So creatures with prehensile lips, rhinos have that. Harvest mice have the prehensile tail. Cats have prehensile claws, so they can grab and grasp things. The giraffe, if you have a look, has got a prehensile tongue. Extraordinary, and I'm not going to look at Ed as I say this. Tapirs have prehensile penises.
Yes, I knew someone was going to have them.
Me too.
No way. Anyway, with all the evolution that's gone on, someone was going to get one.
As soon as we finish here, I'm going to swing home.
What do they do with it?
Yeah, I mean, why did that make them survive?
So much better when you're watching the telly and you can't reach the stand.
Before the remote was invented.
It keeps them
Put the
coupled.
Nachos a bit nearer.
It keeps them coupled.
Yeah. Yeah.
Like barbs on foxes.
Yes, or the pig, which is a corkscrew penis. I know.
Yeah, you have to get one pig and then spin the other pig in.
I think even worse than that, well, for me anyway, the leaf beetle larvae, they have prehensile anuses, OK? It's like a sort of anal turret, and what they can do is they can build shields out of poo on their backs. Ooh. And they place each piece of poo on their backs, and it becomes this sort of growing structure. And they can even move it slightly.
I'm just pleased for them that they don't know that's weird.
Yeah.
They had any sort of consciousness that they were shitting on their own backs, and that was nobody else was doing that.
Yeah.
And I've got an anal turret. Why? I could have had a prehensile cock. I could have had massive bollocks like Ed Gamble.
We have a news flash, everybody. I have the results of the Christmas cracker pulling.
I'm actually quite excited.
Okay.
I am.
I can tell you that Justin got 30 with 4 that didn't crack. Alan got 35 with 7 that didn't crack. Which makes Alan the